Welcome back to Discrete Math. I'm Dr. Jeff Groh. Today we're going to talk about minimization of circuits. As we have seen, we may use the sum of products expansion to yield circuits. However, these circuits might be much more complicated than actually required. So the question becomes, what is the most efficient circuit to accomplish the same goal? As an example, consider the sum to product expansion xyz plus xy bar z. This clearly is x times y plus y bar z. Y plus y bar is always true. And so this is the same thing as xz. So let's look at a circuit designed for this greatly simplified version of this sum to products expansion and the circuit for the original sum to product expansion. So we begin with xyz plus xy bar z. Here you can see that we have a triple AND gate for X, Y, and Z, representing the first term. You'll also have X, Y, and Z, but we'll have to go in to a negation on the Y, and then the AND gate. And then these two go into an OR gate like this. So here you have XYZ, here you have Y bar, so you have XY bar Z, and this would be XYZ plus XY bar Z, yielding a complicated circuit that will accomplish the same thing as the circuit for XZ. So let's see the circuit for XZ. The circuit for XZ is much simpler, just a single AND gate. You can see then, it's important to try to understand this process of minimizing circuits. We're going to outline two methods for minimizing circuits. The first is Carnot maps. More affectionately known as K-maps. This was first written down in 1953, but it has its limitations. It only is useful if you have at most six variables. The second method is the Klein-McCluskey method. It was first written down in 1960, and here we want our literals to be less than or equal to 10. So we'll first look at K-maps. These help to locate terms may be combined in order to simplify the expression. Let's begin by looking at the following if we have literals x and y, then we can have x and x complement here. So y and y complement. We can take products of these to find min terms. And as you can see, there are four possible min terms that one can have with these two literals. The K-map is a similar chart where we use ones and zeros in cells where we have true or false, whether the term is included or not in the Boolean expression. And let's suppose that both of these terms are in there. That means we have the expression xy plus xy conjugate in our expression. But that would reduce to simply x. So anytime you have ones in adjacent cells like this, that means you can combine terms into something simpler. The y and the y conjugate would go away, just leaving this x. As another example, suppose we have ones in these locations. That means our expression has the min terms xy conjugate plus x conjugate y plus x conjugate y conjugate. In this case, you can see that we have adjacent cells both in this direction and in this direction. So how would we simplify in this situation? As you can see by the pairing, this would reduce to x conjugate times y plus y conjugate, this being always 1. You just end up with xy conjugate plus x conjugate. So the plus being like or, x is not true, or x is true and y is not true. Well, this x is kind of superfluous too, because if you aren't in the situation where x is not true, you must be in the situation where x is true as the only rational alternative, in which case we can simplify this expression to simply x conjugate plus y conjugate. So note how that works. If you have ones in all of these spaces, in this entire row and in this entire column, you end up with just these two things. As an example where the Karnaugh maps gives you the situation where you don't have the ability to simplify, suppose the ones are in these two positions here. In this case, we represent the Boolean expression x conjugate y plus xy conjugate. In this case, no simplification is possible. The Karnaugh map would have us have these little bubbles which don't intersect and don't contain any adjacent cells, adjacent being either in the same row or the same column by our definition for Karnaugh maps. In our next example, we're going to look at K-maps for three literals. But we're going to do it in a simplified way. We'll have an x and an x conjugate. And we're going to have yz. Now we adopt the convention that when we go from one column to the next, we'll only switch up one literal. So it's going to be yz bar. In the next one, y bar, z bar, and after that, y bar z. So we're only changing one of these at a time. This gives us xyz, xyz bar, xy bar z bar, and xy bar z, x bar yz, x bar yz bar, x bar y bar z bar, and x bar y bar z. And what is more, we want to make these charts so that the difference between the first and the last is only one change as well. And we're going to kind of think of these as wrapping around to here. So this cell and this cell will be considered adjacent cells. We're kind of like rolling this up into a little tube, into a little cylinder, and we'll move around from cell to cell, and it goes all the way around in a big loop. And this one here will be adjacent to this one here, so that there's always just only one difference between the expressions, the y and the y bar in this case, the y and the y bar in this case. And so you can see adjacent cells will go vertically like this or horizontally, or they'll wrap around like that. In the next example, I want to use K-maps to simplify the following expansions. How about x, y, z bar plus x, y bar, z bar plus x bar, y, z plus x bar, y bar, z bar. Let's look at the K map. We'll have x and x bar. We'll have y, z, y, z bar, y bar, z bar, and then y bar, z, giving us that loop around structure. And let's suppose that we have a 1 here, 1, 1, 1, and that would be it. Here we have the x, y, z bar. That's the one right here. X, y bar, z bar is the one right here. X bar, y, z is right here. And over here, x bar, y bar, z bar. So as you can see, we don't get a wrap-around simplification, but we do have adjacent cells occupied in these areas here. That gives us some ability to simplify the expression. This is all out on its own in isolation, so that term, x bar yz, will be in the expansion. Over here, with these two terms together, the x and the x bar is always true, so you only end up with y bar, z bar. And then on these two, the y and the y bar are together, so you get x, z bar. So this original sum to products expansion with four terms ends up being a simpler expansion with only three terms. Let's do the same thing, but this time with the expression x, y bar, z plus x, y bar, z bar plus x bar, y, z plus x bar, y bar, z plus x bar, y bar, z bar. Let's make the map. So let's make the Carnot map for this expression. Maybe a little longer here. As you can see, we'll have yz, yz bar, y bar z bar, and y bar z. And because we have x, y bar, z, we'll have a 1 here. X, y bar, z bar puts a 1 in this spot. X bar, y, z gives us a 1 here. X bar, y bar, z is a 1 here. And x bar, y bar, z bar puts a 1 here. So as you can see, all of these represent a bunch of adjacent cells. These going in this way, but this too represent adjacent cells. So we get an additional simplification from that. So how does this simplify then? As you can see, the X bar is common, but we have Y and Y bar here. So that will reduce to X bar Z as a simplified term. Now how about these remaining cells? On all of the remaining cells, you have both X or an X bar. So X will be irrelevant to what happens here. But you can also then combine Y bar Z bar with Y bar Z. So what happens with Z is also irrelevant. And so you end up with merely Y bar. So all of these five terms get compressed into these two simplified terms. In the next example, I'd like to simplify xyz plus xyz bar plus xy bar z plus xy bar z bar plus x bar y bar z plus x bar y bar z bar. And so let's look at the Carnot map. We of course have X and X bar, Y, Z, Y, Z bar, Y bar, Z bar, and then Y bar, Z for the loop around. X, Y, Z would be this term here. XYZ bar is this term here. XY bar Z is here. XY bar Z bar is here. And then X bar Y bar Z is here. X bar Y bar Z bar puts us into this spot here. Oh, and let's add one more term. X bar YZ, X bar YZ. That puts a 1 into this spot here. So as you can see, these are all adjacent. These are all adjacent, but these are also adjacent. So how do we simplify this sum of min terms? Well, as you can see, since x, if x is true, you get true all the way across, it's really independent of the truth of y and z. So x by itself will be a single term. All of these won't matter. They'll all compress and just give you x. Now, what's common to all of those in the box over here? X can be true or x can be false. Z can be true or Z can be false, but we want, but in all cases, we have Y bar. So plus Y bar. And then what about this last grouping of adjacent cells? X and X bar. Z is common to both Y and Y bar, so it looks like Z is the one thing that is in common. So three very much simplified terms, as opposed to these seven terms in the original sum of products expansion. In the next example, we'll look at the Boolean expression xyz bar plus xy bar z bar plus x bar y bar z bar plus x bar y bar z. How will this simplify using k-maps? So it's the same deal as before. We'll have yz, yz bar, y bar z bar, and y bar z. X, y, z bar, that would put a 1 here. X, y bar, z bar puts a 1 here. X bar, y bar, z bar puts a 1 here. And x bar, y bar, z puts a 1 here. So where are the adjacent cells? Clearly, these are adjacent, but so are these. So we should be able to get some simplification out of this. And so, in terms of the simplification, you can see between these two, you have a y and y bar. So it looks like x, z bar is more than adequate. For these two down here, you have x bar is common to all, y bar is common to all, but you have z and z bar. That will simplify so that you have x bar, y bar. And with these two, the only difference is you have x and x bar represented in different terms. So those won't matter. You'll have y bar, z bar. However, both of these are already covered in these other two cases, which means this last term, y bar, z bar, is really not relevant. Xz bar plus x bar y bar will be the simplified expression. So how do you handle k-maps with four variables or literals? In this case, it's similar with the, let's suppose that we have x, y, z, and w as our variables. We'll do this in a similar way, but there's a distinct difference. We'll start with xw and yz here. We'll proceed in the same way as we did before across the top. Yz bar, y bar z bar, y bar z. This will allow us to loop around in this way, giving us a kind of cylindrical expansion on our little maps here. This would be your xwyz, xwyz bar, and so on around, because we loop around in this way. But when we come down here, we're going to do the same pattern as we did up there, xw bar, and then x bar, w bar, followed by x bar, w. And you can see that x bar w and xw differ by only one, so we're also going to loop this around in this way as well. So we call this a torus expansion. A torus is a donut like this. We're folding this around and then folding it around the other way, making a torus. That way, this cell is adjacent to this cell, but this cell is also adjacent to this cell. They only differ by this one x and x bar. And this cell is adjacent to this cell, whereas this cell is adjacent to this cell. They're all meeting up as we join this along the torus here. We'll join these sides along the torus. So we have these cells looping around in this fashion. For our next example, we're going to have xwyz plus xwyz bar plus xw y bar z bar plus x bar w y z plus x bar w y bar z plus x bar w y bar z bar plus x w bar y bar z plus x bar w bar y z plus x bar w bar y z bar. And so you can see we have 9 terms here, min terms, in this Boolean expression. Let's see what the Carnot map says on how to simplify this complicated expression. So in creating the Carnot map, we're going to have yz yz bar y bar z bar y bar z, and on the left we'll have xw xw bar x bar w bar and x bar w, allowing us to loop around this way as well. Let's see, xwyz would be a 1 in this cell here. XWYZ bar is a 1 here. XWY bar Z bar puts a 1 in this location. Now we have X, this is the only XW bar term, has a Y bar Z, that puts a 1 in this spot right here. This is the X bar, this is X bar W Y Z, X bar W Y Z, X bar W Y bar Z, X bar W Y bar Z bar, and then we have X W bar Y bar Z, X bar Y bar, X bar W bar Y Z, and X bar W bar y z bar. So as you can see, we can loop to around these. Those will match. These will match. These match. These match here. And this one is all on its lonesome over here. So no further simplification other than these here, given we don't want these to overlap. So let's see what this means for simplifying the expression above then. With these two terms, the things in common are the W's, the Y's, and the Z's. You have X or X bar, so the value of X won't matter. So WYZ will be in the final simplified expression. For these two, the thing that differs is the Y and the Y bar. You'll still have XW on each of these and Z bar. On these two, it's the Z and the Z bar that don't matter. So X bar W bar Y will be the simplification of these two terms. And then these two terms also simplify. The thing that differs there is the Z and the Z bar. So you'll have X bar W Y bar. And then you have this one little term all on its lonesome out here. That has to be tacked on at the end. That's going to be X W bar Y bar Z. And there's really nothing you can do about that one. So in our next example, we'll have X W y bar z bar plus x bar w y z plus x bar w y z bar plus x bar w y bar z bar plus x w bar y bar z bar plus x bar w bar y z bar plus x bar w bar y bar z bar for 7 minterms added all together. Let's see how the Carnot map will simplify this expression. Across the top, yz, yz bar, one difference in each adjacent cell, y bar z bar, y bar z for one change in adjacent cells, xw, xw bar, x bar w bar, and x bar w for the last one. So on xw, y bar, z bar, that gets a 1 in this spot. X bar w, y, z, x bar w, y, z puts a 1 here. X bar w, y, z bar puts a 1 in this spot. X bar w, y bar, z bar puts a 1 here. X w bar y bar z bar puts a 1 here. X bar w bar y z bar puts a 1 here. And then x bar w bar y bar z bar puts a 1 here. So I guess as you can see, there are a lot of things we can do to simplify this all. Obviously, these four are grouped together as adjacent cells. We have all of these, too, and all of this that can be combined. However, we adopt the convention that we only need to attach one additional term together to this grouping over here. Same thing over here. But when you have a whole column like this, it shows that x and w are completely irrelevant. The only thing that matters for this term will be y bar z bar. The values of x and w won't matter for this entire column. For these two adjacent cells here, the things that differ are the z and the z bar. So you'll have x bar w y, the z won't matter. And on all of these, what's the difference? You'll still have x bar, the w won't matter. You'll still have the z bar and the y won't matter. And so in this way, we can greatly simplify this complicated expression into three simple terms. So let's review. If we have two variables, we ended up with a K-map having four cells. With n equals 3, with 3 literals, we had 8 cells. And n equals 4, we had 16 cells. So the total number of cells is 2 to the power of n. 2 squared is 4, 2 cubed is 8, and 2 to the power 4 is 16. So the number of cells in a K-map is 2 to the power n, where n is the number of independent variables that you're going to have. So in the n equals 2 case, we had 2 rows, 2 columns. In the n equals 3 cell case, 8 cell case, we had 2 rows, four columns. And in the final case, we had four rows, four columns. So there's a formula that we can have for the number of rows and the number of columns. It's 2 to the power of the floor function of n divided by 2. Let's see how that works. If n is equal to 2, 2 divided by 2 is 1. The floor function of 1 is 1. 2 to the power of 1 is 2, 2 rows. Here, if n is equal to 3, 3 divided by 2 is 1.5. The floor function of 1.5 is the number, is the integer less than or equal to 1.5, that would be 1. So 2 to the power 1 is 2. If n equals 4, 4 divided by 2 is 2. The floor function of 2 is 2. 2 to the power 2 is 4. So this gives you the number of rows in each and every single case. For the number of columns, it's the ceiling function for n divided by 2. So in this case, you take the integer, the least integer greater than or equal to n divided by 2. So if n equals 2, 2 divided by 2 is 1, the ceiling function is 1, 2 to the power 1 is 2. For 3, 3 divided by 2 is 1.5. The ceiling function would be the next integer up from 1.5, namely 2. 2 squared is 4. And then for 4, 4 divided by 2 is 2. The ceiling function of 2 is 2. And so 2 to the 2 is 4. So this, in all cases, gives you the number of rows and the number of columns. One of the basic principles of arranging a K-map is that in each column, those variables differ by one little element, one little conjugate, as you go across the columns, and as you go down the rows, you only differ by one. So adjacent cells differ by one variation on the literals. We now turn to the Quine-McCluskey method. I'll explain this by way of an example. So for example, suppose we wish to simplify xyz plus xy bar z plus x bar yz plus x bar y bar z plus x bar y bar z bar. Here we have five different terms in this expansion. What we do is we convert each of these terms, which is a string of different characters, x or x bar, y or y bar, z or z bar. We convert them so that x goes to 1, whereas x bar goes to 0. And similarly for y and z. So for instance, the first term is 1, 1, 1. 1, 1, 1. The second term is 1, 0, 1. The third term is 0, 1, 1. The fourth term is 0, 0, 1. And the fifth term is 0, 0, 0. Now, note that between these first two terms, because there's a y and a y bar, the y is kind of irrelevant. So it should end up being combined to xz. Anytime one of these bit strings differs by no more than one spot, that means you can combine them. So we can combine the first and second terms. What other terms can we combine? How about the second and the fourth? Those can be combined. How about the first and the third? And then what about the third and the fourth? And then the fourth and the fifth. So there are all these different possible combinations that we can make because the bit strings differ by no more than in one spot. So anytime that happens, then the terms can be combined. All of the terms, 1, 2, 3, and 4, are represented in some of these combinations, and so we should be able to simplify the expression using these combinations. Notice that the first and the second combine to become 1, and then anything, and then 1, which corresponds to XZ. The terms 2 and 4 will combine to blank 0, 1, which combines to Y bar Z. The first and the third become blank 1, 1, which is YZ. You can see that these two terms can also be combined. We'll do that on a second step. But right now we're just doing the first set of possible combinations. 3 and 4, these become 0, blank, 1, or X bar Z. Note that these two can also be combined. And then 4 and 5, that's 0, 0, blank, or in other words, X bar, Y bar. In the second pass, we can go as many passes as until we have no more combinations to make. These two differ in no more than one spot. So those two, so in the pass number 2, the first and the fourth here will combine, and you get blank, blank, 1, blank, blank, 1. That just corresponds to the term Z. What about these second pairings here? They differ in only one spot. They add up to blank, blank, 1, which also corresponds to Z. And then the only other term left is X bar, Y bar. And so the whole thing simplifies to simply Z plus X bar, Y bar. And that's the answer. I'll just do one more example because I think you can get the rest of the method from here. Let's combine W X Y Z bar plus W X bar Y Z plus W X bar Y Z bar, and then plus W bar X Y Z plus W bar X Y bar Z plus W bar X bar Y Z plus W bar X bar Y bar Z. Okay, so we have 7 different terms here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. The first term corresponds to 1110. The second term is 1011. The third term is 1010, and then 0111. Then we'll have 0101. 0011 and 0001. Okay, what combinations are possible where there's only one difference by one unit value in these bit strings? So let's review these. It looks like 1 and 3 can combine. And when they do, the X term will be irrelevant. We'll get 1 blank 1 0, which corresponds, of course, to W Y Z bar. So 1 and 3 can definitely combine. What other two pairwise differences? How about 2 and 3? 2 and 3 becomes 101 blank, which corresponds to W X bar Y. What other pairwise combinations can be made? Four and five can be combined. We'll get 0, 1, blank, 1, or W bar X Z. Let's see then. How about 4 and 6? 4 and 6 are 0, blank, 1, 1, or W bar YZ. Clearly, 6 and 7 can combine. That gives us 0, 0, blank, 1, or W bar X bar Z. And then we look over these resulting pairs that we have, and looks like these two differ in no more than one spot, and so these two terms can also be combined. When they do, you'll have 0, blank, blank, 1, or W bar Z. So that will be one of the terms in the final problem here. Are there any other combinations that can be made? So we get this W bar Z, and it turns out there are three other terms that haven't been used yet. This involves 1 and 3, 2 and 3, 4 and 6. You don't need to involve all of these, however. Note that terms 4 and 6 are already combined in these other two. So we can actually ignore this term and just write our answer with the other two terms. Like this. Ooh, I did forget some of the other combinations, but this will be the simplified answer. Notice that 5 and 7 can be combined, but those are already covered in other combinations. When 5 and 7 are combined, you get 0, blank, 0, 1. And that can be combined up here. If you combine these two, you get 0, blank, blank, 1, which is, again, W bar Z. So it doesn't contribute anything new. Another combination that we mixed is 2 and 6. 2 and 6 would combine to become a blank 0, 1, 1. Blank 0, 1, 1. This would correspond to the term X bar YZ, but both terms 2 and 6 are already covered in combinations from above. So this term ends up being extraneous, and you don't really need to include it.